Chapter 1. Fundamental Concepts of Algebra. That's what this is called. So what do you think? Anybody want to answer this question? What is algebra? If you open your book to page 1, page 1 in your book, those people that have a book, if not, maybe you can share it with this lovely blue page here. Has a couple of paragraphs about what is algebra and where the word algebra comes from. Been on Jeopardy before? Where does the word algebra come from? So there you go. If you're at Jeopardy Sunday, I don't even know how you say it all, but you know. Some Arabian name. You've been learning algebra for a long time. Probably you would say middle school, but even elementary, you learn algebra. You just use X's, you use boxes, right? Like, algebra, just, right, what's the difference between those two? Nothing. Instead of using a box, you use an X. So you've been doing algebra, my son was in first grade last year, he did this last year, like he's really doing algebra, you just don't think about doing that it's algebra because it's a box or a question mark instead of an X. But algebra really is the foundation for all other math, so that's what you gotta work at. All right, this section is called real numbers, and so the big thing today is I want to go through the sets of numbers. Vocabulary, you need to know this vocabulary, because if we talk about these sets later, I expect if I say an integer that you know what an integer is. So back when you're little and young and learning to count, you started counting with 1, right? Didn't start with 0, you didn't start with negative numbers, you started counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe count to 10 to begin with. You know what those sets of numbers are called? That's a small set of numbers we have. Some people call them the counting numbers, right? Because that's what you learn to count with. But they're really called the natural numbers. You can say counting numbers if you want. They start with 1, so it would be like the set 1, 2, 3, dot, dot, dot. No 0, no negatives, no fractions, no decimals. I always tell the story of my son, my oldest son is 7, when he was little, we had a little play mat that had all the letters and it had the numbers on it, and it was like a little puzzle, and you put it together, but then it was a soft mat you could play on, and it had the numbers 0 through 9 with it, and when I built it, I put the 0 first, like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But it's not supposed to be like that because you don't teach kids 0 when they're first starting to count. Like, you're supposed to put the 0 at the end. You're supposed to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then you just stick the 0 at the end. And as a math teacher, I was very conflicted by this, and I taught my kids 0 came forward, even though most of them so. But it came with a 0, so I felt like I had to go in the right spot. And then the next set of numbers, all we do is add 0 to it. And those are probably numbers that you say these a lot. I think people say whole numbers a lot when they mean integers. But whole numbers, all they do is add 0 to it. Still no negatives, still no fractions, still no decimals. So it's just 0, 1, 2, 3, should be in my space. It's a little more space to write here. Can you see that way in the back? I think I've had this many kids in the class in like 3 years.
Just saying. Oh, dang it, I wasn't supposed to show you that.
So now since I showed you the word integer, how are integers different than whole numbers? Integers include that whole numbers does not include negative numbers. So integers are just all negative numbers and all positive numbers and zero.
So we could say like dot 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 negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, dot dot dot.
Why is it important to know these? Because a lot of times in math problems it will say something like the set of all integers or find two integers that do this. So it's important to know what an integer is when you're doing that. The next set of numbers is when you get into fractions. And you learn fractions in elementary school before you learn negatives, but actually the set comes after it. And it is the set of rational numbers. I really need to like space this out. I gotta add more space in mine. You can tell me what a rational number is. Well, I already told you, I guess, fractions. In algebra 2, when I teach algebra 2, I say a rational number is any number that can be written as a fraction. Math-wise, we would say a rational number is any number A over B such that A and B are integers. And B cannot equal zero. That's the math definition of a rational number. A over B means it's a fraction. To be a fraction, A and B have to be integers. But you can't have zero in your denominator, so we say that. So fractions fit under rational numbers. Decimals, right? Most decimals you can write as a fraction. So terminating decimals, decimals that stop, or decimals that repeat, like 2/3 is 0.6 repeating, 1/3 is 0.3 repeating. So repeating or terminating decimals. If they cannot be written as a fraction, then it falls under irrational numbers. And the definition of an irrational number, not nearly as fancy as a rational number, is an irrational number is a number that is not rational. You have to know what a rational number is. Give an example of an irrational number. Pi is probably the most famous irrational number. Algebra 2. You should have learned about logarithms, and you learned about another irrational number that doesn't get nearly as much popularity as pi, but e is an irrational number. Also, just any square root that's not a perfect square is an irrational number. Like, it goes on forever, it doesn't repeat. Square root of 5, square root of 51, any square root that's not a perfect square is an irrational number. And then together, all of those make up the real number system. So the real number system is the set of rational and irrational numbers. Minute about these sets of numbers. And notice I just said the set of rational and irrational. I didn't say the set of natural, whole, integer, rational, and irrational. Why didn't I list them all? Do all natural numbers fit into the whole number category? 3, is 3 both a natural number and a whole number? Is every natural number also a whole number? Yeah, but the difference is 0. 0 is not a natural number, so we can't say every whole number is a natural number. What about the next one? If I went from whole numbers to integers, is every whole number fit into the category of integers?
Yeah, it's kind of like it's a subset of it.
What about rational numbers? Is every integer also a rational number? Could you write every integer as a fraction? Yeah, you just put over 1, right? So the reason that we can say the set of real numbers is rationals and irrationals together is because integers are rational numbers, which means whole numbers are rational numbers, and natural numbers are rational numbers. And so they're all subsets. We're going to kind of make a little chart in a minute to show you that. In your Algebra 2 book, there's like this lovely Venn diagram that shows that they're all just subsets of each other. Something I've learned or talked about this summer for the first time, and I thought it was interesting when we were talking about it, is all of these sets have infinitely many numbers in them. Do you agree with that statement? Natural numbers, do they go on forever? Rational numbers, you can't really write rational numbers out like I did the other ones, but do you agree there's an infinite number of rational numbers as well? But thinking about subsets, are there more rational numbers than there are whole numbers? Thought about things going on to infinity and one having more infinity than another. That's a weird thought, right? Levels of infinity. That's what I spent my summer talking about. Levels of infinity. That there are levels of infinity. Your infinity can be more than another infinity. So infinity isn't like the end all talk. So I would say rational numbers is a higher infinity level than integers or whole numbers or natural numbers, because there's way more rational numbers than there are integers. And so that's just some abstract concept I just wanted to share with you, because the professor this summer talked about sharing that with like her 7-year-old, and I thought if she was discussing levels of infinity with a 7-year-old, that maybe I should discuss levels of infinity with high school students. So, yeah. What about complex numbers? Anybody know how to define that one? Last year, well, whenever you took Algebra 2, I've had most of you freak out, so, Algebra 2 is when you talk about complex numbers for the first time. What do you think of when I say the word complex number? You know, last hour, I took everyone's name, and I wrote it on a piece of paper, and I started drawing them out of the basket to get people to talk. But I need to resort to that. Or, I can just give you all a number, and then I'm going to roll dice, a few dice, because there are a lot of you. Whatever number I roll, like, whoever's that number has to talk. Happen. Complex numbers.
The complex number is all real numbers plus letters.
What kind of letters? Not talking about variables here with complex numbers. Like, what is the new thing you learned in Algebra 2 when you solve Eustace? Right, up until Algebra 2, you would say you couldn't do that. But in Algebra 2, complex numbers make us allowed to take the square root of -4, because what did you learn? Imaginary numbers, right? The imaginary unit. So complex numbers is a set of all imaginary numbers plus real numbers.
Set of all real and imaginary numbers. Sorry about the bad penmanship.
Or non-real numbers, but sometimes we'll call imaginary numbers non-real numbers, because for some reason they use this word imaginary, and you all think of it as like an imaginary friend that you can't really see. But imaginary numbers are real things. Like, it's a real idea that they call it the imaginary unit. So,
and I taught algebra 2 years ago, someone called them invisible numbers. They're not invisible. Okay, so there's just a little chart in your book, and I kind of wrote it out, but we can make little squares around it if you want. But basically, complex numbers is like the big idea. And then a subset of that is real numbers, and we could even say non-real numbers or imaginary numbers. But the imaginary numbers kind of stop, right? There's no subset of imaginary numbers. But these real numbers, we can keep breaking down to all those things we just did. So we can say real numbers break down into rational numbers and irrational numbers. And then again, irrational numbers stop. There's no subset of irrational numbers. If it's irrational, it's irrational, it's real, that's it. But then rational numbers have all those subcategories as well that we just talked about. And so rational numbers, subset of integers, or integers is a subset of that, I mean, and then whole numbers, and then natural numbers. And so instead of like a Venn diagram kind of thing that's in your Algebra 2 book, this book kind of makes it up like this little, I don't know what it's called, subset map maybe? So if I said 7, what type of number is 7? It's a lot of things, right? Tell me something that 7 is. It's a natural number. It's a whole number. It's an integer. It's a rational number. It's a real number. It's a complex number. So the numbers that you've known your whole life are everything, right? And when you get into more complicated things, you're going to have maybe not as many things. But like a fraction, like 1/2, starts at rational. 1/2 is only rational, real. Yes? No? Maybe? Move on. Okay with that? Well, the picture in your book on page 3, they put like 0 in there, so I think that's. You don't have to write this down. But we're on the next page, kind of leaving that. Your book says this, and I just thought it was kind of an interesting way to word things. The real numbers are closed relative to the operation of addition and closed relative to the operation of multiplication. Any clue what that statement means? If the real numbers are closed under the operations of addition and multiplication. Chase, you'd hate for me to send you ISS on the first real day of teaching. It means that for every set of numbers you can think of, every two numbers, or every pair AB of real numbers, there's exactly one real number A plus B and one real number AB. That might seem silly, but it means when you take, like, let's say A was 2 and B was 3, when you take 2 plus 3, you can only get one thing out of that. You've known that your whole life. This is very, there are certain operations that you do in higher level math that aren't closed. There are certain types of math that you can add two things together and there's more than one answer that you could get. And so I just thought I wanted to mention that to you, that it is closed under addition and multiplication. Okay, and the same thing with multiplying. It doesn't mean that 2 plus 3 is the only way you can get 5, right? I think sometimes people get confused by that. It just means when you add 2 plus 3, you're always going to get the same number, just fine. Right. Here's what I want you to do. I'm tired of talking for a while. These are all properties that you've learned about in your life, but maybe you don't know what they all mean. I want you to take a few minutes and talk with someone near you, maybe like partner up by row or someone behind you, and I want you to write down what you know about these properties, or when you see the word inverse or identity, do you know what it means? Could you give an example of the distributive property or the commutative property or the associative property? In geometry, when you did those algebraic proofs, these were the properties that you were using. I thought people like algebraic proofs better. But let's take like 6 minutes. 6 minutes, that sounds good. And see what you can come up with and see if you can give me some examples of this instead of me just having you sit there and write them down or sleep while I'm writing them down. And then I'm going to either give you a number or I'm going to write your names on pieces of paper and I'm going to call it out and you have to tell me what you know about it. Okay? Ready? Go. Distributive. At least you got that one, right? You can write it on your paper. You can kind of just take notes on it. We're going to write it out in a minute together. but I want you to be prepared to answer these questions. Work with someone around you, even if you don't know them. Introduce yourself. I'd like you to see what you can do with algebra there first. Alright, but be able to explain it. Don't just read to me what's in the book, is the other part of it. Of what does it mean if you're here?
Thank you.
want to talk it up. So then as they run out, then it's going to make the fresh arm. A basket of things. I can't find my dice. I'm going to do numbers, but it doesn't tell me where things are. Check my scene chart so I look in the right area. Oh, Jordan.
Yes.
What do you got? Which one do you want to talk about?
Additive
identity. What is the additive identity?
You add zeros to a number and you gotta equal that number.
A number plus zero will always give you back the same number. Right? So the identity for addition is zero. What number can you add to any number and always get back? Number plus like the negative of the number equals the identity for that number, right? So identity and inverse kind of go together. Inverse, you can kind of think of the operation that undoes it or gives you back. What do you do to undo addition? You do subtraction, or in this case, the opposite, the additive inverse. So, questions about that? Anyone think of it a different way? So the identity for multiplication is still what number do you do that operation to get back the original that you start with, but in multiplication, it's 1 that does that. So the identity for addition is 0, the identity for multiplication is 1. Will. So what about the inverse? Let's look at the inverse. If for addition, when you added the identity, you got back what you started with. Well, you're not looking.
I'm trying to write down the definition to the identity.
All right. You tell me when you're ready. Look at the addition one. We took a plus 0 and we got back a. And then the inverse was what? A plus what gave you back 0? So I think that same thing should apply to multiplication, only using multiplication instead of addition, and using the multiplicative identity, which is 1 instead of 0. So I think by just basing on that, it should be A times something should multiply back together to give me the identity, which is 1. So what could I multiply A by that would give me 1 back, you know? No, because if I took A times 1, wouldn't that give me A? Who can help him out? The inverse for multiplication is division, or if we're typing it as multiplication, if we're writing it as multiplication, it's its reciprocal, right? So the inverse, or the multiplicative inverse, is reciprocal. Alright, so we tend to not use the word multiplicative inverse. We say multiply by the reciprocal, but that's the technical word for it there. And I would have never started with these. I would have totally started with the top ones. So it'll commute it properly, that's my favorite. Or distributed. I'm surprised we just distributed. Alright, we only have 3 left. Megan. Commutative, associative, or distributive property. Which one can you tell me about? You get to pick. It doesn't matter. We have to do all 3. Commutative. What does a commutative property say? Both. How could you one word, like, what is that saying? A plus B equals B plus A. Right, like, that's what it says in the book if you look at community property. Anybody have any thoughts? Like, what does it mean? If you had to describe to someone, what does the community property say we can do with addition? Or multiplication?
A times B equals B times A.
What's that saying? When you add or multiply, the order doesn't matter. You're allowed to multiply in any order that you want. You're allowed to add in any order that you want. We use that property all the time when we group things together in the way that we want to add or multiply. You just don't think about it, but that is the property that you use. Chase. Distributive. A on either side, right? Distributive is probably the one that we do the most often, that we actually call it the distributive property. Which is just 3A, which you could also get another way. But yes, distributive property. I think associative, I'm just talking about the six. That's what I was going to go with. Taylor. And I think this, it's the same thing with multiplication, right? You could do A times B times C equals A times B times C. What does that mean, right? When you write it, what does that one mean? Associative and the commutative property are kind of saying the same thing in terms of addition and multiplication. I think they're similar. In commutative, you actually switch the order around, but in the associative, you have more than two things. It's just saying, like, if you want to add B plus C together first, or you want to add A plus B together first, it doesn't matter. And again, it's something that you've learned forever, but we usually just write them every year and forget about them. But properties, therefore. I wrote these concepts down, and I don't have a lot of notes for these because I feel like you tell me what you need to know. Absolute value. Who can tell me something about absolute value or the definition of absolute value or anything you randomly know about absolute value? Always positive? Except what if I had this?
Oh, that's tricky, right?
But inside absolute value is always positive. You know a definition we could say for absolute value? A number distance from zero. That's why it's always positive. But yes, absolute value bars, you do what's inside, and then you always take the positive, even if it's negative. So I'm going to say distance from zero. We're not even talking about absolute value graphs right now. They're just using absolute value bars, and they just want you to be able to evaluate them. And we'll talk about that after you do some homework. Inequalities, I hope that we're familiar with inequality signs, less than, equal to, greater than, equal to. Anybody have any questions about that? Hopefully we're past the point of thinking about the alligator mouth. The alligator being the bigger number. I was going through this making notes, like I just felt silly writing notes about inequality, so I just thought we should just mention it. Okay. Scientific notation. Hopefully you've taken some science classes, you're all juniors or seniors, right? And you've used scientific notation. Yes? Are you all juniors? Or else? You're all seniors? Oh my goodness, you're all seniors. Yeah, positive exponents, are big numbers, negative exponents are, small numbers, like decimal numbers, right? So, there's stuff on your homework today about like putting in scientific notation or going from scientific notation back to standard notation. And we can talk about that more tomorrow if you need to, but hopefully it's not that big of a deal. I do want to talk about the notation on the calculator, because people always get confused by that. Kids that have calculus get confused by that. Most of the scientific calculators, if you had something like this, like it has like a little times 10 maybe, or even just has like the number over there, right? Have you seen that on your scientific calculator where it puts the little exponent up there? On some calculators, it does an E, right? So it might say like 2.36E13. That E just means times 10 to the 13th. My graphing calculators do that. And so you just need to be aware of the notation on how your calculator does it to use that. So it's really nice when it automatically puts it in scientific notation, but some of them use that E, and which is just a calculator speed. You would never write that on your paper as an answer, E13. I want you to know that that means scientific notation. Questions about that? Here is the homework for section 1-2, page 13-14. I want you to do 2 and 7. You're going to learn very quickly that in this book, there's lots of like parts. Like, so on part 2, like parts A, B, C, and 7, they want you to use inequalities. And then 33 through 40, you're supposed to say equal or not equal to, and there's a lot of symbols there using the properties, and maybe just simplifying. Try those. We can check your odds for that so you know if you're right or wrong, and you'll know what questions to ask. And then I just threw some other ones there. 53 and 55 are scientific notation stuff, but it shouldn't take you very long to do that homework. And then tomorrow we'll talk about questions and we'll move on. Wednesday, the plan will be to do the application for Ivy Tech. So make sure you, I'll keep reminding you about social security numbers so that hopefully we can get that done as soon as possible. I believe there, that says 1-2. That should probably say 1-1 up there. Sorry. I'm already jumping ahead to 1-2. I believe there's a quiz after section 1-2 already. So maybe like in this week, if I can get a copy of the quiz from Ivy Tech, we'll be ready to. And they're just 10-point quizzes, so they won't take the whole hour to do. So we'll probably come in, review, and take a quiz, and then we'll see what happens after that. No, they're real quizzes, by the way. They're 10-point quizzes, and you read about the syllabus there, but there's 12 quizzes, but you only keep the best 10. So you get to drop your two also. Not homework quizzes, the tests, 4 tests, and then a final exam. I do say if you've read the syllabus, if you do better on the final exam than you did on one of the 4 chapter tests, then the final exam percent will replace your lowest test. Does that make sense? So like if you got a 70 on a test, but you got an 80 on the final exam, then that 80 will count as your that lowest test grade also. So that motivates you to try to do better on the final. But yeah, so hopefully we'll get through section 1-1, 1-2, and take